council. The first application before you is the Red Bull Switchboard, which is a surfing event that will be held on Asbury Avenue Beach on February 4th from 6:30 to 10 a.m. Second is the Lobster Run from 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. on April 15th on the boardwalk. Third is the New Jersey CASA 5K run from on May 6th from 7 a.m. to 11:30 a.m. This one's for you on May 13th. Again, this walk would be held on the boardwalk from 8 a.m. to 11 a.m. Asbury Fresh would like to return to Kennedy Park to do their annual farmers market beginning May 14th and going through November 19th. Take Steps for Crohn's and Colitis Foundation would like to do a walk on May 21st with the registration and festival taking place in Bradley Park and the actual walk taking place on the boardwalk from 9 a.m. to 12 noon. The Asbury Park Sheehan Classic 5K and Kids Races on August 12th on the boardwalk from 6 a.m. to 2 p.m. It should be noted that the race will actually end at approximately 10 a.m. on the boardwalk, and then they'll return to Bradley Park. Mind Travel would like to return to do another silent concert on the beach on August 20th from 7:30 to 9:30 p.m. The American Cancer Society Relay for Life will do a walk in Bradley Park on September 23rd. It should be noted in the application that they speak about camping overnight on the beach. That won't be happening. Everything will be held specifically in Bradley Park. Shoreline Heart Walk on October 1st, again, specifically on the boardwalk, walking on the boardwalk. Free to Breathe Run Walk for Lung Cancer on October 21st, using just the boardwalk. And lastly, we have three weddings, one on July 2nd, next on July 30th, and the one for August 5th has been canceled. Any questions? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Review of agenda items.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. This evening for resolutions on the consent agenda is the special events and RCA project, which is a 614 Second Avenue. On the individual resolutions, appointing Acacia Financial Group Incorporated to serve as financial advisors. Acacia was not put on the reorganization meeting. We missed them. They are the city's financial advisor for financial projects and our debt service. We're recommending, they're not changing the rates, so we're recommending this approval. 1 year, resolution 2017-50 is a 1 year extension for the contract with Real Property Data and Verification Services. This is recommended from the tax assessor. This is as part of the Monmouth County tax assessment demonstration program. The city bid this out approximately 3 years ago with 2 1-year extensions. This is the first of the 1 year extension. Resolution 2017-51, the menu items.
We'll go back to 50 for a second.
Yes.
What's the cost?
I don't remember. Let me pull up the, see if I can pull up the resolution. Is it in there?
I don't know. I didn't see it.
I know the contract information is attached. I'm not sure it's specified.
There was no cost increase from last year. I'm trying to pick it out.
Well, the last thing I have is signed April 3rd by Steve K, 2014, so I don't have anything from last year.
Because it was a 3-year contract, so last year there would have been none. no,
So what's the cost for this?
I'm pulling it up.
Go to page 62.
I'm getting there. $22,000, I believe it is, for this year. $85,000 total, $22,000 a year.
Michael, why don't you move that microphone a little further away?
Where did you find that? What page?
Appendix D, the overall contract costs, $88,000. Over the full year, it's approximately $22,000.
Okay, I'm lost. I got appendix D. Where do you, I don't see those numbers you're saying.
The planning and organization is $76 a month. The data collection, those properties have increased a little bit. It's about $1,100. And then the $424 a month for commercial. So that's 12, 18, approximately $19,000. And then there's been additional properties, according to the assessor, that have come online. So his cost, when he told me, was approximately $22,000.
Did somebody say there was no increase?
There's no increase in the cost.
Well, if I go to Appendix F, packet page 64, it has class, blah, 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 vacant land, $20 per parcel. And then if I go to Appendix G, it says vacant land, $26 per parcel. So to me, that's an increase in cost.
That's the difference for that. If you read the first sentence in F and G, F is if you have the assessment demonstration program, which we do, so it's $20 per parcel. And for G is if people are doing it in-house. Some municipalities have been doing the inspections in-house, such as Middletown. And that's where, if they're using them to supplement, it's a $26 cost.
It's not just 26, there's a couple of hundred dollars.
And $100. So we're not doing this, obviously, in-house. So it's Appendix F.
So we shouldn't even gotten G.
It's part of the contract.
Okay.
What we've been doing internally is, as you noticed, attaching all the contracts to the resolution so we actually have a better record of them. So when they submit the contract, it all gets put into the resolution.
And just explain for myself and the public what exactly they're going to do.
They are going to visit approximately 20% of the properties in the city. From there, they take pictures. They ask to go inside to ensure that the property card is accurate. And this counts as an annual reassessment so that it continues our 100% ratio, so market value and assessed value are the same.
And again, and I apologize for one more time for a cost not to exceed?
Approximately $22,000.
Thank you.
Resolution 2017-51 is going to be tabled. I'll skip 52 for a second. Resolution 2017-53 is a resolution authorizing Verizon Wireless to use poles erected by parties that have lawful right to maintain poles within the public right-of-way in the city of Asbury Park. This is, in a nutshell, Verizon is going to be putting small wireless antenna nodes on some of our utility poles to ensure that they have coverage. They don't know which poles they're going to be using yet, but under the state agreement with Verizon, this is one of those things that we have to accept at this point in time because they have a statewide franchise agreement. Once they actually give us the plans, we can review them under building and public safety, but this is, Verizon has identified the city as an area that needs better service. These poles were first tested in the state. One of the first places was during the Super Bowl. They're square boxes that went around Giant Stadium, whatever it's called, MetLife Stadium. to ensure that Verizon services were met. It worked very well. I was working up in New Jersey at the time. But again, as Verizon has a statewide franchise agreement, there's nothing really the city can do other than ensure public safety. If they break it, they fix it in their insurance requirements, and that's listed in the resolution. Resolution 2017-.
A couple questions. Go to page 95. Verizon would like to receive non-site specific consent granting permission to locate and operate in the right-of-way of the city of Asbury Park by attaching to existing and new utility poles, and then would later obtain and require site specific permits. So they could come in and say, I put up 10 poles in the City Hall parking lot and then ask for permission later.
That's the state franchise agreement language. This is all copy and paste from the state franchise agreement. They still need to get the electrical and building permits.
Why wouldn't they just, out of respect, ask this first?
It's Verizon. That's
okay. Can we attach our devices to their poles? Can, they put up a brand.
They're
new
not
pole.
Putting up poles. This is a pole, and they put a box on it, which is wireless.
They're asking for the permission to put up new poles also, if
no.
need be.
If need be, but at that point they need to come to us.
Okay, so can we? No, that's not what it says.
For poles within the right of way, they would have to come to us. But if they put
after
a
pole, after the fact.
Yes.
Okay. Can we put our cameras or other devices on their poles?
Yes.
Where does it say that?
It's we do it now. It doesn't need to say that.
Can we get that to say that?
I don't see why you couldn't, but it's already permissible because it's in the right of way. We can put the cameras up in our right of way. The only thing that has to happen is Verizon has to sign off on the electric to the cameras, which is usually the delay. We had that with a couple of cameras now.
Okay, thank you.
And the last resolution in which the city planner is here is 2017-52 to grant a license to permit improvements to the area of the city right of way adjacent to a property located at 901-911 Asbury Avenue, which is block 403, lot 8. This was tabled from the last meeting. If you recall, this was work within the right-of-way, inclusive of grass and sprinkler system, and Michelle's here to give a little bit more detail.
This was a condition of approval from an application before the Zoning Board of Adjustment. This was a two-phase application. The first phase was to build artist work live housing in the B2 zone. And during the course of the application, it became known that the applicant wished, as a phase two, to convert what is now a used car lot to a form of drive-through retail. So he was asked by the Zoning Board of Adjustment to submit everything, but submit it as a phase project, a phase one, and a phase two. Because he wishes to retain the building that exists on site, which is currently, I believe, an office for the used car dealership, he is limited in the circulation around the site and the parking. So because it is a parking lot up against the sidewalk, he actually has a landscaping requirement. He asked to fulfill that landscaping requirement in the public right-of-way area. And then as the board engineer, Insight Engineering, requested of him, made a condition of approval that he put in an irrigation system to ensure that that landscaping is watered, maintained, cared for. So part because it is a it's in the public right of way, it needs council approval. That was it's not listed in the board resolution exactly like that, but it's a condition in the engineer's report, and the zoning officer will not release permits for the phase one until he fulfills all the conditions for the phase one and the phase two. That's why this is before you tonight. He received the variance from the Zoning Board of Adjustment, not for the retail component, because drive-through retail is permitted in the B2. had received the variance for density for the live-work space in the phase one. If you go to the site now, you can see he had started construction on the live-work units, and that's when he was stopped and told he had to go to the Zoning Board of Adjustment. That is the phase one. And like I stated before, the phase two is where the used car dealership is currently.
And just by way of background, this is the property, if you'll recall, it's at the corner, the northwest corner of Asbury Avenue and Memorial.
I understand. Are there questions and concerns with this application tonight?
Is this something we do often?
Yep.
To meet the landscaping requirement?
With an irrigation system?
Or to allow them to meet the landscaping requirement on public land?
Is it done often? That I cannot answer because I've been here a year and a half. I have seen two other applications with this. You, in fact, are going to get another one coming up where it's a small landscaping requirement. One of the things in Asbury Park, as you know, is what many people consider part of their front lawn is the public right-of-way.
Right.
A few months ago, the council approved a retaining wall in the public right-of-way as a license agreement because the people thought that it was their front lawn. And the property next door had put up a retaining wall. And while I typically don't recommend all these encroachments in the public right-of-way, the one for the Zoning Board of Adjustment makes sense because if he is going to use the existing building.
Move the mic from your mouth.
And you should have the drawing in your packet that shows the building location. That is the existing building. Did not want to expand the footprint. He just wanted to rehab it. And then to meet the parking obligation is why the circulation is shown the way it is on the number of parking spaces. And that is then why he's asking for his landscaping requirement to be in the public right-of-way. And then the board engineer asked for the condition that it be irrigated. Which is smart.
So if we grant this, does the right-of-way become part of their property?
No, because you're granting a license agreement that can be revoked.
Correct, Counselor?
Correct. It's still gonna be under city's jurisdiction and authority.
So this is
and the reason we tabled it 2 weeks ago, because we had nothing except one piece of paper. We had no maps. We had no nothing. So do you have any problems with this?
Yeah.
Theoretically, no.
Okay.
Would I have liked to have seen a better landscaping plan and a slightly wider sidewalk? Yes. But I am not the board planner, so I wasn't part of that decision. But in the future, we will be more part of that decision. One of the requests that I will make that I think I did, I actually put in the draft resolution, is that this should be approved by the Environmental Shade Tree Commission. And I did put that in the resolution. So then if they think there should be a greater, better species of plants and a wider sidewalk, that can be so.
This is a highly visible property. It's right on the corner of Asbury
yes.
Memorial. So my concern is, the appearance.
Right. But your concern is the appearance of the plant material or the building itself and the parking?
The overall landscape plan, what is this going to look like, actually?
Right, so what you have before you is, again, like what I said, what I thought was pretty basic, which is grasses, natural grasses, lawn, and a tree species that I'm not an arborist, that I think there could be a better choice for street trees. That is why I'm asking that part of the approval be that the Environmental Shade Tree Commission give their input on what should be planted there. But if you are more comfortable, you could obviously table this and ask for input ahead of time and a redesign, although I have to say that the property owner is very much itching to be able to get his permits released for the phase one. This is for the phase two, so this is not going to happen for a while. So you have a choice, it could be conditional, or you can't ask for a revision.
I'd like to see something more than this that I can't even read.
So are you saying if we don't approve this, it's going to hold up his phase one?
Yes, because the zoning officer is asking that he fulfill all the requirements of the engineering report. And in the engineering report, it requires that he put the irrigation system in for the phase two.
That doesn't seem fair to me. And we have no other recourse?
Could we table this, could we hold this over to the next meeting? I mean, we're talking 2 weeks at this point, right?
You have to table it?
I'm just asking if we could. I'm not saying that's...
We did it the last time because we didn't have the drawings.
There's not enough information here to make a decision.
Well, the information, is there. Because I can tell you it's natural grass. It's natural grasses. It's lawn, and it's plum trees for in the public right of way. That's why I said it's pretty basic.
And it does require that the property owner has to review the plantings with the shade tree commission.
Right.
To make sure.
Yeah, well, that makes me feel better.
Right.
Michelle, are you recommending that we approve this?
I'm recommending you approve it with that condition, and that clearly that the board and the applicant have to be open to a switch up in the species being planted. But I think we can also add a floor amendment, just add the language that this council, you know, highly recommends that there be more landscape material.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, we'll move on to discussion items. First one, item one, payment in lieu of parking ordinance.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. So as has been discussed previously, there is a $3,000 per space payment in lieu of parking fee currently in place for the CBD. The fee is not exactly codified, and it's been felt that it's too low, which I would agree with. So what I did was put together a memo that walked through some of the rationale for a higher fee. I have some rationale in there from the parking committee as to the fee amount that they were recommending prior to my actually coming to the city. Then I did a kind of a case study of other municipalities in New Jersey who have fees in place and what those fees are, as well as some research on nationally what's going on, what the trends are. Additionally, we did some research as to the cost of a structured parking space, as this fee is intended to eventually create structured public parking. And that's listed there. And based on those recommendations and some strategies that's recommended kind of in the industry, I recommended a base parking fee or a payment in lieu of parking fee of $15,000 with an incremental fee on top of it for the number of spaces. And what the incremental fee is meant to do is, as a site is deficit of the required parking, as that number grows, that fee actually grows, the per space fee. So the intent is to try and discourage having too many spaces being deficient for the site. I chose the $15,000 per space base fee in order to come below that, you know, the structured parking fee as a strategy not to discourage development. However,
what is the structured parking fee? That's the 20.
It's anywhere between $18,000 and $20,000 per space. That's kind of the industry standard in New Jersey. for what that is. So we wanted to bring that a little lower just to, you know, not discourage development. However, it's generally felt that that number may even be too high for Asbury Park. So I think, you know, my final recommendation is we should increase it some amount. So at the end I said, you know, at least let's make it 5,000 base with a $100 incremental fee. What that would mean is, for example, right now if a site in the CBD was deficient 10 parking spaces, it'd be $30,000 they'd be paying. With a $5,000 base fee and a $100 incremental fee, 10 parking spaces would be $59,000. So it'd be almost a doubling of the fee, which I think is a pretty good number to at least start with. So,
so a structured parking spot for, and I'm just gonna use layman's term, in New Jersey goes for approximately $20,000, $18,000 to $20,000.
Approximately.
Okay.
A year,
right. And our parking
that's the cost of constructing,
right,
a structured parking space.
Right. Mm-hmm. And our parking committee came up with a somewhat similar number,
yeah,
correct, when they did the analysis.
Yeah, they had recommended initially at 25,000.
And so if we, going from 3 to 20 is obviously a big ask, right? That's a huge ask, and I get that. Is there the ability to go 5? And then in 2 years, 8, and then in 2 years, 10, and then put it up to near, and maybe not at, but near what structured parking actually costs and what you and the parking committee are saying we should actually be charging. Like, can we phase in higher? Go. We could start at 5 because I think,
sure,
we all understand that we've been under and we don't want to put anyone into shock. Mm-hmm. Start at 5 and then start to look in the future to phase it higher and higher.
I think that's a good idea. I mean,
okay.
I think we should start somewhere.
Right. Okay.
So is that, are you thinking 5 with the $100 increment for?
Well, I would say higher than $100 increment, right? So in 2 years, we would go to, we would evaluate going to maybe, just so we're not hitting, we clearly are under $3,000, across the board, nobody thinks that's an appropriate,
right,
amount of money.
Right.
Our parking committee thinks it's 20 something. You think it's between 18 and 20. People are going to go bananas at that amount of money,
mm-hmm,
understandably. So I just think it's a increasing it incrementally over time and letting people, you know,
adjust.
Get used to the idea.
Who's going to go bananas?
I don't know. Maybe nobody will go bananas.
No, the answer is the developers.
Right.
And the answer is, to me, is, again, this is all my personal opinion. I don't give a damn about the developers. Because 12 of these people are already going to be grandfathered in. So they're going,
right,
to pay the $3,000. And then I look at how many other spots are left. And truthfully, you know, we're worried about developers being ticked off that they may have to pay the right amount, but we're not concerned about the citizens that live downtown that right now, if we keep on adding 50 spots here, 50 spots here, 20 spots here, that's more people that live downtown and work downtown and shop downtown that can't find parking,
right,
spots. So all we're doing is helping the developers by giving them a cheaper rate, which I liked your first rate of $15,000, and you said, however, is believed that the development community will react to this figure unfavorably. I don't care. That's my personal opinion. Personally, and I've said it before, I think there should almost be a moratorium on everything downtown as far as parking, because in some of the projects you have listed, I mean, like, you don't have the VFW listed as a potential project that could be expanded. Now, that was sold, and that could be turned into like a 6-story condo building with 80 some condos, and
I'll defer to Michelle, and she helped me put together the list,
right,
of properties.
Because that, you know, that zone has a height limit.
Okay, okay, there could be 10 more condos there. With how many condos can be there, if you know the number?
That I don't know, looking at the footprint, but yes, it could be, you're right.
10 more condos with 30 more cars or 20 more cars, because 1.5, so 15 more cars back out on the street. But we're making the developer happy, but meanwhile, anybody who lives downtown, anybody that visits downtown, anybody that tries to go to the stores, any business, any employee, anything, they suffer, but the developer's happy. So why aren't we trying to make the developer say, guess what? You're making a fortune developing, so build parking. Which Carter Sackman came in a couple weeks ago and gave a beautiful plan for a very big building, and he supplied all the parking. Why not make everybody supply parking and get out of this business of saying, oh, pay us and don't worry about it?
Because that was not the intent of the CBD plan. If everyone...
Well, maybe the CBD plan is wrong.
No, but no, not to be, you know, not to be disrespectful, but the, in order to keep the pedestrian flow and not have a lot of curb cuts on the sidewalk, that was part of the idea why parking should be centralized in one location. Also, many...
Where's that location?
Well, that's the redevelopment plan had three sites specced for structured parking.
And no structured parking.
Two of the three were not built for structured parking, and the last site that's left is the one that you had the presentation on two meetings ago.
So two of the three are failures. We have the 554 Lake Avenue in front of the planning board now, which was postponed another 2 weeks or whatever. And they're putting another 40 cars, approximately 40 cars on the street because, hey, I'd rather pay you $3,000, $120,000 than provide parking for my development, which I'm making a bundle.
Right, well, I'm not saying that is right, but as you notice, for the parking they did provide, they have no windows on the ground floor. And it's fun, you know, it's okay, not great, for even for Lake Street, because that was not meant to be a main retail corridor. But all their facade is garage door, blank wall that they did propose landscaping, and, you know, and a door. For them to be able to provide parking, that is not what you typically want for your pedestrian-friendly downtown. And that was part of the idea with the plan. I have to admit, you know, we probably missed the boat for the other two sites, not requiring that those be those the parking sites before they were developed and received approvals. That is why for that last site, there's so many cars that were proposed for it, because that is the last large footprint site in the downtown. And the other large-ish site is the one before the planning board, and you see what the facade looks like when you need to have provide the parking. It's passable for Lake Street. That is definitely not passable for Cookman Avenue to have that type of facade.
Well, sites 8, 9, 12, and the unmarked VFW are not miniature sites. Okay, and say the VFW doesn't become condos. It becomes a nightclub, and they have to provide zero parking.
That's right. That is
so,
permitted.
So well, I know it's permitted, and that's the problem with this. That's the problem with the CBD plan. Is like we keep on saying people build, but there's no more parking. So eventually we're going to be like, people are going to get tired of riding around in circles looking for parking spots.
But I just want to make a note, nightclubs are not permitted. Restaurants
okay,
are
whatever the correct word is.
What's the difference about the interpretation was there that they're every one with a liquor license is supposed to be a full-scale restaurant.
What about House of Independence?
They have a spot amendment
okay.
for their use. There are, so, but restaurants, are bars are not listed as a permitted use.
Again, it's just me personally. I'm like, we're more concerned making developers happy than residents,
and businesses.
Business owners, employees who I don't even think should get free parking. That's my opinion. But let's make the developers happy and let's make them rich. And then they give us all these problems. And all we do is get our backs busted. I'm not coming to Asbury Park anymore because there's no parking. And if I keep on doing this, that's all we're doing, guys. So if you make the price the right price, which we said, parking committee said 20,000, 25,000. Michael said 15,000. And the next one would be 15,500, 16,500. So if you had 10, it would go up to 19,500, be a total of $195,000. That would be substantial to a builder to say, I got to figure out a parking plan or else. Because right now it's so easy. Only an idiot would provide parking and not pay $3,000 or
right.
$5,000.
But I do want to take a step back and say, one of the basis for doing lower than the price of a structured space is that other municipalities in New Jersey are charging the five. Michael looked at Metuchen.
California, Broadway. South Beach.
And I'm sure others are charging more.
Yes.
So, I mean, but I don't care about California. I don't care about Metuchen. I care about Asbury Park.
Right.
And everybody says we do not have a parking problem down in the CBD should have their head examined. I mean, so.
I mean, we agree.
Okay,
we agree.
So why do we keep on making it worse?
So the only counter, I'm going to say, in terms of, so I don't think necessarily, for a entity like iStar, paying $20,000 per space is like, I'm going to assume very, very easy for a smaller developer developing small spaces. I'll use the showroom, for example.
Right.
Granted, they don't have to, they are commercial. They don't have to provide the space. Essentially, we'll put you out of business. Five units is $100,000. You're spending $100,000 on parking off the bat at $20,000 a space. I think if you want to keep, I think this is going to have no effect on people like iStar, but the smaller developers like Patter, whoever have put their time and money into the Central Business District far before iStar or Madison or anybody else came around,
none of them,
they are going to have.
None of those are in the CBD. iStar Madison, they don't even qualify.
But my point too is that the developers in the downtown, for the some of the smaller ones, for $20,000 a space.
There's very few small ones left.
Okay.
They're fairly
there's
good
very,
size.
Very few right. development yeah. properties left.
Right, it's not like everybody's saying like the downtown's underdeveloped. Well, geez, guys, you know, I walk downtown, I think it's pretty much developed.
The one thing I would agree with is Michael's recommendation that there is affordable housing.
To cut the number in half, I have no problem with that at the original price.
That we would for market rate housing.
To apply that to the top number, I have no problem with that.
Yeah, most communities like cut it in half basically for affordable.
Okay.
So I have no problem with that.
Right.
That would be the top graph and cut that in half.
Well,
I agree
okay.
with that. But to reduce it to $5,000, you might as well just leave it at $3,000. And yeah, right.
I don't think anyone thinks leave it at 3,000. I think going from 3 to
5
15 is, it, listen, personally, going from 3 to 15 is a big ask for me. If there's 3 votes for it, by all means, I don't care.
But okay,
so I mean, I think that's why, you know, we wanted to lay it all out there and, you know.
Do we worry about the redevelopers who haven't developed, or do we worry about the citizens who live there and the businesses that right now can't get parking? I mean, to me, it's no-brainer. We worry about the people now. And not the future.
But
and if they want to redevelop, they can come in, and they could even come and ask for a waiver if it's something special. Like you say, well, it's only like 20 by 20. I can only put 2 units there, blah, blah, blah. But these are not small parcels. They're still left available. And unfortunately, we missed the boat, and 10 are already grandfathered in at $3,000 a piece, including the Savoy with 68 cars.
Well, that's the thing. If it's developed as approved, yes. If the developer decides to come in with a different scenario, then no.
Right, and I'm not a soothsayer, so I don't know what they're going to do.
But I also just want to state this is also why, though, Mike did it as an incremental increase, because if there is a small developer who wants to do a few units, because that's all they need to do, they're a small footprint, it's a smaller price, but then if someone is doing a lot of units, the price goes up. But again, this, you know, it's a, this is just the information that, you know, Mike and I had put together and took into consideration various things. It's of course this council's prerogative to do it as you see fit for the municipality.
Thank you for the information.
And this will require an ordinance, so when you're ready to move this forward, we'll have the ordinance prepared and ready for introduction.
Sure.
Thank
you. Move on to the next item, New Jersey School Board Association Resolution for School Board Recognition Week.
We're
on a second item, New Jersey School Board Association Resolution for School Board Recognition Week.
Okay.
Michael asked for this to be put on.
This came from a council member asking if there should be a resolution recognizing it's actually School Board Recognition Month.
Oh, sorry.
It's a resolution recognizing the school boards and the work that they do throughout the year.
So
do you want a resolution for the next meeting?
So yeah, when we do a proclamation, we do proclamations.
The next item is amendment to the personnel policy. There's two changes that are substantive. One is it adds the New Jersey Pregnant Workers Fairness Act language, which is obviously a state law that we can reference. And then there is a supervisory dating policy, which is recommended by the Municipal Employee Liability Insurance Fund. There's been some issues in the state where a supervisor has been dating a subordinate and it has resulted in favoritism, whether it's overtime or pay raises, and that the insurance funds are recommending that there's just some language that someone is notified so that this can be taken care of and addressed if that does happen. So that is, those two recommendations are the big aspects of the personnel policy, and that is going to be recommended for a resolution at the next meeting. Is there any questions on that?
No.
And then the last item is the 2017 capital improvement program. Just like last year, we'd like to try to get this done sooner than later so that we can actually go out and get equipment. It's two parts. The second part is road repaving of approximately another $1 million of roads. It is similar to last year's program with some exceptions. Last year, it's the three police cars, so we can have an annual replacement program. There's some accreditation upgrades that need to be done in the police department. They've obtained quotes for that. Social Services is interested in getting a van to replace the bus. The van would also work with recreation. Recreation's van, if you remember, broke down on the highway last year. It's been tabled for two years now, or 3 years for improving. Additionally, staff is recommending keeping the bus just because it is something that can be used in emergency situations. There's the DPW sweeper, which is to replace the old green one. This is a real full-size sweeper. also needs to replace a pickup truck. The building department needs to replace a vehicle. The building vehicle will then be brought down to another department, which is an SUV. Continuing security measures in this building and citywide IT are two items. Planning of the Main Street streetscape. If DOT funds Main Street, when they do repave it, the city is responsible for providing the streetscape that they take out. The trees, the bike racks, the benches, the garbage cans we have to replace. We do have a grant out there for that. This money covers both the grant and any other obligations that we'll face. We would like to start a program to replace traffic lights and some control boxes for the DPW. The first traffic light we'd like to replace is Redwood and Ridge, where you have the hanging lights. We want to replace the hanging lights with real traffic lights with ballast and arms. Fire department, personal protective gear, which has been the annual replacement program. The police department needs to put in cameras and some other electronics in various cars that weren't done over the years. The continuation of replacing garbage cans throughout the city, and then soft costs are just the general costs associated with issuing the ordinance. $3 million is the same as last year. It is no increase to the budget as part of debt service because we've been minimizing the debt service of it. These are all, again, replacing items that have been past their useful life. Moving forward, it's really just vehicles and the lighting moving forward. But this is done through the budget process with the departments that have been recommending. CFO and then myself put this together as part of the program. What we would like to do is have council permission to have bond council draft the ordinance for the next meeting. And it's a fluid ordinance. We can, if there's, say, a question on the van, we can actually just put administration van or other equipment or other vehicle so that we can at least get the process rolling. It's fungible at that point in time. We don't necessarily have to buy a van, but it allows for the future purpose, and then we can't have something if we don't need it.
So if you say the van is to replace the bus, but we're not getting rid of the bus,
right,
then it's not to replace the bus.
It's to replace the usage of the bus. Right now, the bus that we have isn't full most of the time.
So then why don't we sell the bus?
Because I would like to keep the bus, social services would like to keep the bus. One, it's a good OEM thing to have. If you have to do an evacuation, it does get rid of people because it's so large, and at that point, we won't care about it. So we can go through water, we can go through whatever we face. And if we do have a larger event, we actually have something that we can utilize.
How much of the cost to repair the bus?
I think it still functions. We still use it.
The bus is fine.
It just needs to be.
We're just buying a $50,000 van.
To cover two departments.
Well, we have two, right?
Yeah, so to use a bus, what would potentially be, from what you're describing, two or three times a year, maybe, for, you know, I mean, the last evacuation we probably had was Sandy. I think if we're buying a van to replace the bus, we should then get rid of the bus.
It's to replace the usage of the bus. If you want to get rid of the bus, get rid of the bus, but we can use the bus. And
then why do we need a van?
Because the bus is getting older, and the van is to cover two departments now.
Why can't they currently use the bus? Why can't the two departments use the bus we currently have? Why are
because
we buying a new van?
It's too big and it requires a CDL license, so we pay more for a part-time driver when a regular van that we want, you don't need a CDL. There's no class associated with it.
Mike, I'm a little confused. I thought we had two buses for recreation.
We have two vans.
Two vans.
Two big van buses, yes. But
so you
there, one, remember, is garbage is broken down. It's had some issues over the years. And it was proposed to be replaced 3 years ago and never was.
Don't we have a police explorer van?
Yes. Sir.
That could be used for recreation.
But that has all, is outfitted with police equipment.
Do what?
I believe that is outfitted with all police equipment. There's a radio system in there.
But why would that matter if you're just going to put the recreation kids in it? Who cares
really
what it's outfitted?
Because if there's items transmitted over radios, you don't want people to hear that.
Can't you turn them off?
Good.
So you turn them off and you use that van.
Okay.
Is that the van that Officer McGallister to use in the summertime for his program?
I don't know who drives what piece of equipment.
If you want a van for social services, I just say get rid of the bus.
I
just don't know why we'd have a bus sitting around that we're never using.
I agree, but and we have plenty of time to give you feedback before this needs to be done, correct?
Takes kind of lose both couple days.
Just because we invited some people to be recognized tonight at 7 o'clock and they're here, so.
Yeah, this is the last thing on the agenda.
Okay, so we can.
And we're not voting on this, are we?
No, this is not on tonight's agenda.
Do public participation.
So, I'd rather recognize the VIPs. We'll talk about buses. Mm-hmm.
All right, in lieu of the time, we're just going to roll right over into the regular meeting. So right now, I'm going to do the roll call. Councilmember Chapman.
Here.
Councilmember Clayton.
Here.
Councilmember Kendall.
Here.
Deputy Mayor Quinn.
Here.
Mayor Moore.
Here.
Please rise for a silent prayer, a moment of reflection, please. Flag salute. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. As to comply with the Open Public Meetings Act, Chapter 231, Public Law 1975, adequate notice of this meeting has been provided in the following manner. The annual notice was forwarded to the Asbury Park Press, the Coast Center Star Ledger on January 3rd, 2017, and posted on a bulletin board the same date. All notices are on file with the city clerk. At this time, we would like to proceed with the recognition of the City of Asbury Park High School 2016 varsity soccer team. Yay.
Coach.
obtained its first NJSIAA sectional title in 35 years, and whereas the team's feat on the field, finishing with a record of 18-4-1 and two crowns for the Shore Conference's B Central Division and Central Group 1 championships, are as commendable as their feats off the field, volunteering at local nursing home, Asbury Park Recreation in the summer, and various March of Dimes events in the fall. And whereas their altruism, industrious work in the classroom, on the field, and in the community, as well as their team spirit, has proven to be their linchpin, is evidenced by their Group 1 championship win, overall record of 18-4-1, and a perfect divisional record of 12-0. And whereas some of the Blue Bishop soccer team members have been hailed as being among the Shore's top talents, and whereas these gentlemen, scholar athletes, formula for success, on and off the field, is both extraordinary and noteworthy. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the mayor and council of the city of Asbury Park hereby commend the Asbury Park High School Blue Bishop soccer team for their outstanding, notable achievements. Be it furthermore resolved that the mayor and city council congratulate the Blue Bishop soccer team on their exceptionally successful winning season in 2016.
Okay, we have
Michelle Bibark is not here. We have Marco Solis, Roddy Echen, Vanessa Echen, Giovanni Frater, Oswaldo Garcia, Marco Solis Lopez, Brian Cruz, Alberto Moreno, Jordy Gonzalez, Johnson Evers, Emmanuel Mendoza, and we have, that's about it.
You didn't read the coaches.
Oh, the coaches. Dave Johnson. And we have one final guy, Team Jordan's time, he's going to get somewhere.
Thank you.
this mic?
Is that an iPad or?
I mean, maybe he was just saying, I mean, what else? Right?
Absolutely.
All right, we'll move on. We'll move on to matters by the city council. Anybody have matters?
I have nothing at this time.
I just want to announce that there's going to be two events this weekend because of the Martin Luther King Jr. observance. The first will be Sunday, January 15th. It will be hosted by the Asbury Park Neptune Ministerial Alliance, and it will be held at First United Baptist Church, 906 Grand Avenue, and that will be 6 o'clock, and that's Sunday evening. The second will be on Monday, and that's hosted by the Central Jersey Club, partnering with Cathedral International, and it will be held at Cathedral International, 1200 Grand Avenue, and it's at 12 o'clock, from 12 to 2:30. So I hope that you will come out and celebrate this very important holiday. Thank you.
I noticed that we have the Recreation Committee here. Would you just stand and raise your hand, let the public know who you are? And we appreciate you coming and recognize the soccer team along with coming to me to the meeting. We appreciate you. I was very impressed with you guys yesterday. Showed a lot of class, and our goal is to move forward on recreation. I think we have a fine committee, and I appreciate you. Thank you for coming out.
So the only thing I'm going to add in terms of both the soccer team, next meeting we will be honoring the state champs on the football team. Also, APTV has done interviews with some of the soccer players, about 7 or 8 of them, and we're going to put a piece together, and they kind of talked about, you know, methods they use to win after 35 years. And the same is happening with the football team. So not only, you know, is this a great, you know, opportunity to give them a proclamation and highlight kids that are doing great, but stay tuned to APTV and there'll be pieces on some of the individual players along with the proclamations and individual certificates. That's it.
Couple quick questions. Last week we had a car go through a house on Prospect and Bangs, and the fire department did a great job. So number one, I want to thank the fire department. And a follow-up question. Now, do we go after their insurance company for all the overtime and everything that was incurred?
In town, for stuff that happens within Asbury Park, we historically have not, but it's certainly something we can look into.
For this one, I think we should. Okay. I mean, somebody drives through a house and we have to go in there and call an overtime and hold up the house, I think the insurance company is going to pay, not whatever, look into it. And then last night we had the gas rupture over on Madison. Do we go after that contractor also?
That would, in that case, it was the water company.
So I wouldn't care if it was okay. Whoever it was. Do we go after them as far as like all the costs incurred by the city?
The short answer is sometimes. And we've done it once before where it was obvious negligence. We could look into that again today.
Okay.
I can tell you that last night it was on the scene, it was blamed on something not being marked out properly, so it's negligence.
Okay. If you look into both of them, just let us know in the future. I appreciate it. That's all I have. Thank you.
Matters by city manager?
None at this time.
Matters by the city attorney?
I have nothing at this time.
At this time, can I take a motion to open a meeting to the public?
Move it.
Second.
All right. Each public member has 3 minutes to speak. When you come up to the mic, please state your name and address for the record, please.
You're on, Rita.
What do you think? Hi.
Yes, absolutely.
First, I want to say Happy New Year to everybody. I haven't seen everybody.
Thank you.
Secondly, I was looking at my old records, and these are last year's numbers. 562,278 and further. This is all tax-exempt properties. I was really upset when I heard that the zoning board approved another tax-exempt program in this town. I don't think you realize how many, I know the council might know, I mean, people like John will know, that how many halfway houses we have in Asbury Park. And to approve another one, I think it's terrible that something like that happened, that the zoning board didn't look in. And then I heard that somebody at the meeting asked them why they came to Asbury Park, and they said they were invited here. That's what really got me mad. I mean, I think it's ridiculous. I can give you a list of all the halfway houses in this town. This is one little square mile. There's no reason for this. And the other thing I want to, John, I think you were absolutely right about, we don't always agree, but we do agree on this, about the parking. It used to be 25,000 a parking space. 15,000, I guess, is a better number. But you know, at the Esplanade, they charged $30,000 to have a garage at the Esplanade. So, I mean, $15,000 is not a lot of money. And especially that Saxman built 550 Cookman Avenue, he hardly pays any taxes because he's in a pilot program to begin with. He pays less taxes than some of the houses in Asbury Park for all those properties. And now he wants to build on the back of it and he doesn't have enough parking spaces? Too bad. I agree with you, John. You better start thinking about the taxpayer in the town. You don't need any more development to begin with, as far as I could see. This is one little mile. Why do we need all these people living here? Especially on Cookman Avenue or on Lake Avenue. And the other thing I wanted to talk about was about the tax-exempt properties. Many, many years ago, John will remember this, that there was a mayor named Frank Farentino, and he imposed all tax-exempt properties pay for their sewerage, which was a good thing. And now every tax-exempt property in this city pays at least sewerage. I think you should impose another assessment on them, like maybe 20% of what their property is worth for their garbage pickup, for the police, for the firemen. They get all these services and they don't pay anything. I think it's high time, and including the churches, they should pay too. I mean, there's only a few taxpayers picking up the full tab here. Between the pilot programs and the tax exemptions, which I just gave you an old number. It's probably much more now. I didn't get the new numbers yet. But could you please look into at least maybe assessing them, the tax-exempt properties and the churches, and bring in, at least keep our taxes the way they are. They go up every year. I know what you're gonna say. You're gonna say, because we get $1 million from the state. We don't even need that anymore. So I'm just saying, it's high time that these people pay their fair share. These halfway houses that are in town, I don't think you really realize how many we have all over the place, plus the Mission, plus the HIV place, plus the Sisters of Mercy on Main Street, three buildings, plus a parking lot. I mean, you have to talk to the people on the zoning board and the planning board. I don't know if you have meetings with them. I never heard of anything like that, but I don't know. Does anybody agree with me?
I do.
Huh? One? One yes?
I count to
three. Okay. No, but I mean, it's ridiculous that the zoning board would pass a halfway house just because it's going to be a new house. And the next thing, they'll have another house on that lot, and that will be a halfway house. I thought we were trying to improve the West Side working class people market value.
Your 3 minutes are up.
Huh?
Your 3 minutes are up, and
I know they're up.
And you're wrong.
Huh?
You were wrong that what I was going to say. I wasn't going to say anything about transitional aid. I was going to say, I don't think we can tax churches. We'll look into it. I mean, it's state law. Now, what we can do when nonprofits are tax exempt, start generating income, we tax them for a percentage. Same as years ago, Neptune taxed the hospital for the gift store. So if a Salvation Army or something, or the Boys Club starts using the swimming pool and charging, we have taxed everybody and everybody, anybody across the board for the portion they're using and generating income. I don't think it's legal. We'll look into it, but I don't think it's legal to tax churches.
Well, I think Asbury Towers is the first example you can look at. They pay in lieu.
Well, they pay in lieu of.
Yeah, well, they pay, no,
but
they
that's
pay.
That's not a church.
No, if they don't pay in lieu. They pay a special assessment.
Okay, but okay, okay, but it's not a church. I don't think we need to tax churches, but we'll look into that. And as far as the planning board and zoning board, do we meet with them? Absolutely not. They're separate autonomous agencies that run their own shop.
Well, I know when people want to build something, they come before you first, and I don't ever remember you approving the halfway house in the last year, but maybe you did. Maybe I was sleeping, calling, sitting there.
I can't remember either. We'll check it and get back to you. Danny?
Okay. Sit down. Thank you. Appreciate it. Okay, first, Happy New Year to everybody. I was going to discuss just one issue, but now I probably, maybe I can discuss one.
Can you just state your name and address for the record?
Yeah, Danny
Sorry.
Harris, 17 Ridge Avenue, Asbury
Park.
Okay,
thank you.
Okay, that means you give me back 20 seconds. In reference to the recent snow, and I've already talked to Councilman Kendall and Mayor Moore about it. People get up, shovel their sidewalks, shovel their driveways, make it a point not to throw snow into the street because we know it's against the law. But to come home yesterday after paying people, because I recently had a knee replacement so I can't shovel right now, to see that my entire sidewalk is covered with snow, heavy snow, because the city in the process of cleaning the street just go right back down the street and the entire street where everybody on our block had shoveled to make sure a quality of life, we can walk and people don't fall in front of our houses and we get sued, and the city comes right down the street and pushes it all back. Now, for some of us, you go out there and shovel it again. For others, you have to go out, bear the expense, pay somebody else to clean it up. I would hope that the city would, one, manage the people a little better and tell them when they go down the street shoveling snow, slow down. Don't go, as Mayor Moore and I talked about, 30 miles an hour that throws the snow back up in people's yards. Go a little slower. Don't push it on the sidewalk, because a lot of people leave home in the morning to go to work, and then when they come back at night, the snow's back there again. And now it's frozen, and now they can't get it, and if somebody falls in front of your house, then you risk a lawsuit. So, and also the fact that the city was not out on the streets Sunday after the snow, I think was mismanagement, and I think it should be done a little better than that. Second, reference to a halfway house, and I might need an extra 30 seconds if you can bear me out. I'm on the zoning board. We did approve a rite of passage house for Prospect Avenue for homeless youth in the Asbury Park, Neptune area, which will be done by Covenant House and Interfaith Neighbors. And to stand up here and to be so callous to talk about a halfway house not being available to homeless youth in Asbury Park, I think is, you know, probably short-sighted and insensitive towards the children of our city. There are a lot of kids walking around here right now, which we call couch surfers, kids who don't have a place to stay and who stay from one place to the other. The zoning board, we sent the people through, honestly, we sent them through hell before we approved it, as far as safety, regulation, security, and 20 seconds, and check their track record as to the two halfway houses that they ran in Newark and in Atlantic City. So it's not bringing any detriment to the community, and as far as what's being built over on Prospect Avenue, it's actually going to help make the community look a little better. But a lot of times before we stand up here and blast people over something that is needed for the poor, first realize who it's needed for before we become insensitive and make remarks in public about it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, no cross conversations, please.
The only thing I'm gonna say is the microphones are a little bit more sensitive, so you actually should lean farther from them than, I know the natural reaction is to lean towards them, but it's actually better to be farther from them than towards them. It still picks it up.
Hello, Mayor and Council. Happy New Year to all of you and professional. Okay, if you all have a pen and paper in your hand, I'd like you to write down for the parking garage. If you put $25 a day times 7 equals $175 a week times 4 gives you $700 a month times 12 gives you $8,400 at the commercial venue. That means that parking garage is a gift that keeps giving. If you do it for residents at $200 a month times 12 at $2,400, that means the parking garage at $25,000 pays for itself in 10 years. That's a great investment for the development. If you do everything by math, you only get one answer. You want to listen to people cry for the developers? The developers are friendly people. They are not your friends. I just really want you to believe that. You guys understand that part? Okay. Then the other thing, I've been asking all the time, what are the goals now for 2017? I don't really care that you don't have a timetable for the redevelopment. That's one person's opinion. I believe as a council, you should have a timetable on the computer so people can see how slow things are going. You want to switch it and say the glass is half full? Well, it's really half empty right at this point. And people need to know what's going on. The other thing is, it'd be good for Main Street to see how you guys are progressing with that. Now, 2017, what are the goals for the city manager? I really like to know. I'm sure the coaster would like to know, or the sun would like to know. What are the goals for the department heads for this year? I wanna, like, put it in writing. You got a pen and paper, math does not lie. Find out how much money they're saving this year over last year. Then the other thing is, we really don't need any more pilot programs. We lost lots of money with the ratables being knocked down ahead of time to clean up the beachfront, which does look better without the building, but the taxpayers are paying a high price. And then with numbers, pen and paper, tell us how you're holding down the numbers, because you can say all you want, but the taxes keep going up. If you really want the city to be a comeback place, it's a hot location. You know what would be a big thing as a realtor for me? Hey, you know what? The taxes didn't go up this year. You're making a smart investment. Thank you, Council.
Okay, and thank you, Jerry. And we're hoping at the next meeting, I'm not guaranteed, the worst case scenario, the first meeting in February, you'll have a report presented by the city manager on the achievements and goals. We're hoping next meeting. For some reason, this has been a crazy first couple
weeks.
It's always rough. No, it's been crazier than usual. January, we're a little bit behind because so many other projects are going on that take attention away from, but at worst case scenario, the first meeting in February, you'll have the report you're looking for transmitted through the city manager as far as goals and accomplishments in 16 and goals and what we want done in 17.
Thank you very much, Council.
Okay, thank you.
Ernest McNally, 400 Deal Lake Drive, Asbury Park, New Jersey. I was here at the last council meeting and I brought up an issue about the holiday decorations, the situation with Kennedy Memorial and Fireman's Memorial. The city's position now, which is very different from surrounding municipalities, is that they're installing holiday trees, which are neutral and they're fine, but they're taking donations from, I believe, Sackman and I don't know, Hanukkah by the Shore, or one of the local synagogues, and the DPW is very nice. You're handling the storage, you're sending out the electricians to sink them in the ground, and someone's lighting them, and it's a beautiful thing to see. For the last 2 years, I've offered to donate a nativity scene. which would make us in line with every other community around here. And last week, or last meeting, I brought forth that the city manager is refusing to communicate with me. And I don't like to come here in front of an audience and make it seem like, well, who's this disgruntled citizen? But I'm an American citizen, and there are constitutional rights with regard to religion and equal expression, and those are being thwarted. So I didn't get a response. The city attorney, the only response I ever get when I'm here is, it's noted, I've read the emails. Well, for how long do you note something? And then I call Ansel Grimm, where he's from, and he doesn't respond to my call. So I don't understand. Is it like the city attorney and council is being paid with my tax money to, let's say, litigate against me or put me off or make me seem like I don't have a right to my rights? I mean, really, doesn't Mr. Raffredo work for me in a sense? And this is an issue for the city. I'm a resident. In my building, they were refusing to put the nativity scene next to the tree and next to the menorah. It took me 6 years. I finally got them now to realize, you're gonna put the bush, the tree, it's okay. But if you put the menorah, you put the nativity scene. For me, I wanna see both. They both fall at the same date, and that's the law. You follow the Lakewood case a few years ago, it made national press. You know that, Mr. Moore, it made national press. And unfortunately, the settlement was that the one side decided, well, if you're gonna put yours, then we're gonna take ours down and you can't put yours. It was a horrible outcome. But I don't think we have to come to that. And I don't think I have to come to go sign a intimidation complaint against the city manager for not responding to me for my city and constitutional rights. I still have 20 seconds. I don't know what else to say. Why can't I get a response to an email? Now, I'm on this video from the last meeting bringing this issue up. All I get from the city manager and city attorney is what I'm just doing now. Don't I deserve a response?
Yes, you do. And
will I
gonna say you'll get a response within a week, because I remember the last meeting I asked the city attorney, should we respond? And the answer is no, because you mentioned litigation. So, no, but, no. Okay. No,
that was your interpretation. I didn't mention litigation. I mentioned a complaint against the city for bias intimidation. That's not a complaint.
But I agree with you. And Fred and Michael, can you draw up a response to the question as far as the nativities?
Why the two?
They're gonna work on something and give it to us, and then we're gonna look at it because we set the policy. But you know, they have to draw something up. And as far as when you call Ansel Grimm, Aaron,
don't
Fred,
do it.
What?
Don't do it.
Well, Fred's under directions by the city. Do not pick up the phone, because when you call, you're raising my taxes. So we cannot have every citizen call the city attorney, because that's billable hours.
Really?
Yes. Any attorney. So any city. So.
Well, isn't this city business? Am I mistaken something? What are you saying? If I had an issue with opening a bar in Asbury, you would let this lawyer spend 50 days on Mr. Mack's expansion of 5 bars on 1 block. But if I call and I talk about I want a nativity scene, well, I'm wasting city attorney fees. How does that?
When a developer, and I'm going to cut you off first, when a developer requests a 50-day extension, they set up an escrow account. If you want to set up an escrow account for every time you call the city attorney, I say go ahead. Deposit money and we'll deduct it every time you call the city attorney. But we cannot have 16,000 taxpayers calling the city attorney and running up legal bills.
There aren't 16,000 taxpayers.
Okay, 16,000 residents. Okay,
I wish there were 16,000.
Okay, but we could have people from Manasquan call. We've had people from out of city call, and Fred has responded, and I put a stop to it. Well, I said, no, you're done, Ernest. You're done. The 3 minutes is up, and as far as you get an answer, I agree. So can we start working on getting an answer?
Absolutely. And I will just reiterate, it's not specific to any particular person. Generally, I've not been permitted to take phone calls from residents of Asbury Park, because I have to charge for my time, and then I'm charging the city for someone's private issue that they're calling about. Whether it be, even if it does involve a public issue, I have to be authorized in order to incur an expense to the taxpayers of the city of Asbury Park. So that's why I always recommend that anyone who has an issue go through city officials as opposed to contacting my office or any other professional that's going to bill the city, because, you know, it's not something that Asbury Park authorizes or other municipalities typically authorize, because this is something that happens elsewhere, and that's typically a policy across the board. So it's not specific to this particular individual. It's generally speaking.
No, it's definitely not specific. It did not start with you. It goes back. It goes back several years. No. No. Okay.
Motion to close.
Move it.
Second.
And when I said you guys are going to work on an answer with the nativity scene in a timely fashion.
Absolutely.
Before the next meeting?
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you.
All right, we're on to minutes. Minutes of December 28, 2016.
Did you want to go to the public?
Yeah, I'm sorry, I've never done this.
So. Oh, okay. Go
ahead. No. Motion to open. Second public portion.
Reopen.
Hi, my name is Chelsea Patberg. I live at 200 Deal Lake Drive. This has probably been addressed in the past, but I just moved here in July, so I just wanted to come and ask. We love the dog beach very much. I go there just about every single day in the summer. It's wonderful. It's a wonderful resource. I was just wondering, is there a reason why there's not a foot washing or a spigot when you come off of the beach there? Is there maybe just no water hookup?
Because this time of year it would freeze.
I don't mean now. I mean in the summer.
Oh, in the summer?
Yeah, there's no water spigot or foot washing station.
We could probably add, I don't know. That's going to be a question. That is run by DPW. I know the water goes as far as, like, say, where the trailer is and the ticket booth is.
Mm-hmm.
The water line probably stops right there, so it would mean running, like, another 300 feet of water line down there. But let us check and see. And again, with this type of weather, we wouldn't do it this spring anyway.
I don't mean
now.
I mean in the summer.
No, but the first time anybody's ever asked, so good question.
Would it be possible maybe then to run a long hose? It's just because with the surfing beach and then with the dogs, a hose would actually be more beneficial, I think, to residents, because then you could kind of spray them down before you head home. And maybe if the water line stops, a long hose could be a cheaper source than, you know, extending a water.
It would be more expensive because it would be stolen every day. we had complaints about the dumpsters not having canvas tarps over. We went about very expensive canvas tarps, and somebody now has a nice tent up in the Poconos. So, no, it would have to be the same type of thing with the showers or something like that, where it couldn't be taken.
Or even, like on the 7th Avenue Beach, if there were maybe after hours if dogs were allowed down there to hose off and come back. Because I know right now they're not allowed past the signs. But if there was somewhere, I guess, just to wash the dogs off before, you know, heading back. Like if we were allowed to bring them down at 7th after 6 o'clock. Something like that. You know, just something that would allow residents to hose the animals or surfboards down before, you know, heading back.
Let us look into it. If you want to leave your name and phone number or something instead of coming back or something. I mean, we're not going to look into it tomorrow, next week or something.
No, I understand.
It's when DPW, and we can get in touch with you.
Okay. I just figured it was worth asking. Thank you.
Thank you.
Motion to close.
Move it.
Second. Minutes. December 28, 2016. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
We're on to a consent agenda. We have only two resolutions this evening. 2017-47, resolution approving special event applications, and resolution 2017-48, award a contract for regional contribution agreement project, which is for 614 Second Avenue. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it. Second.
Any comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
We're on to individual resolutions. The first one is resolution 2017-49, putting Acacia Financial Group to serve as a financial advisor for the city and authorizing the execution of agreement of professional services associated therewith. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Any comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2017-50, authorizing 1-year extension for the contract with Real Property Data and Verification Services. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2017-51, this is identifying the menu items. Are we tabling or withdrawing?
Tabling. Because we want to vote on it at the next meeting.
Can I have a motion to table, please?
Move to table.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2015-52, authorizing the city of Asbury Park to grant license to permit improvements in the area in the city right-of-way adjacent to the property located at 901-911 Asbury Avenue, Block 403, Lot 8. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Question? Didn't we say we're going to change the language?
Yeah, well, that's what I was going to ask Fred. So what do we have to do? Make a motion to amend it as per Michelle's recommendations?
Yes. Just give me a moment. I'll pull up her.
We wanted shade tree approval on.
Well, that's in there already.
Well, it doesn't say approval, though. Right, the way it's written right now, it says that the property owner shall consult with the shade tree. So if you'd like to change that to approval of the shade tree, that can be part of your amendment. And then the other item that Michelle brought up was to add a provision that the council highly recommends more landscape material.
Yes.
Okay. Is that what you want? Sure.
I think that's what you want. Yes.
Yeah, but I mean, okay.
Yes.
Yeah. So what do we need? A motion?
Can I motion to amend, please?
Move it.
Second.
To add both of those two items to the resolution that's part of your package.
Okay. All in favor of the amendment?
All
right. Okay. And then we have a motion and a second on the table for approval of the resolution.
Yes. As amended.
As amended.
Yes.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2017-53, resolution of the City of Asbury Park authorizing Verizon Wireless to use poles erected by parties that have the lawful right to maintain poles within the public right-of-way of the City of Asbury Park. Have a motion?
Move it.
Have a second?
Second.
Comments or questions?
What would happen if we didn't approve this?
They
would just go ahead and do it anyway.
Yeah. But this way, that would require insurance. It requires the insurance. It requires that if something breaks, they have to fix it. If not, they can just come and do whatever they want.
Without, they have insurance to cover anything anyway, though, right?
This is the agreement that says they have to provide it to us.
And to name the city as an additional insured.
If they don't,
some additional safeguards.
If we don't have that, how do we go after their insurance?
Can we change the agreement? I mean, they're asking for approvals after the fact.
You can, and they'll still do what they want, but change the agreement.
So if we approve it, we'd be protecting ourselves, then, right?
You're not protecting anything. Verizon is a statewide agreement to do anything within the public right away.
It also says that they can add poles, and they can add a pole wherever they like, and we can't do anything about it?
That is a statewide agreement.
Yeah, if you read the attachment, Michael's absolutely right. State law supersedes us, and they can do whatever they want.
Yes, and then every once in a while, you'll see in the newspaper, especially in South Jersey, how a town is complaining that Verizon has been built out. In exchange for a statewide agreement, they said that they would build 100% across the state of New Jersey in FIOPS, which they haven't.
So I'm clear, if this fails, we're actually less protected.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Because then they don't give us insurance.
Okay.
And have a motion.
And that's legal?
Yes.
It's legal, but it really sucks.
So we would not be covered. They would not be liable if anything.
They would still be liable, but we wouldn't have the insurance information to go after.
Well, could we get insurance information?
Would you give it to them? If I was Verizon, I wouldn't give it to us. At least we have the cert, we have the contacts, we have every bit of information. We have this, states that if they damage something, they have to fix it. We can go after them. They're going to be required to post escrow. They're going to be required to go for building permits.
They're asking for building permits after the fact.
They have to have building permits to install the micro towers.
So they won't do any work without permits, is that what you're telling me? Because that's not the way it reads.
That is the first, that's the second part of it.
But we can't deny the permit.
No.
So it's a catch 22.
It drives me crazy. Like, it's almost like, why even vote on it? It's done deal, but.
For insurance purposes, that's why we vote on it, right?
Yes.
Okay, so let's just go for a vote.
By adding the insurance, we protect ourselves. Where originally I was gonna vote no just as a protest vote. I'll be not that hard-headed and vote yes just because of the insurance factor.
Okay, we have a motion and a second on the floor. Councilmember Chapman?
I'll say disgruntled yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes, under protest.
Councilmember Kendall?
I have no other choice, yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
And Mayor Moore?
I fib, no. I vote yes, and it really does. I mean, can we get in touch with our legislators and tell them, like, yeah, we hate shit like this? Excuse my language.
Well, my favorite word for you is that if you remember 2 years ago, the city cost us about $75,000 in what's called the business relief tax, because once Verizon gets rid of 51% of the copper phone lines, they don't have to pay that tax anymore. So the city lost about $75,000 a couple of years ago, and the schools lose money because of the statewide agreement, because this is what happened. There's been municipal efforts to change it.
Maybe we should find out who their lobbyist is and hire them.
Okay, we'll move on to ordinances introduction. We have ordinance 2017-1, amending and supplementing Chapter 2, Administration, Section 2-47.6b, Representation, Sunset Lake Commission of the Code of the City of Asbury Park, New Jersey. Can I have a motion to introduce this ordinance?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Public hearing for this ordinance is scheduled for January 25th, 2017. Motion to adjourn.
Move it.
Second.